Beloveds, God seeks and sees the good and potential in everyone more than we ever can. Our God's compassion knows no limit. In this knowledge, we can come, we can leave behind the things which hold us back and simply accept God loves us, and so we worship. Beloveds, welcome to worship at Emmanuel United Church of Christ, found here in Dousman, Wisconsin, or wherever or whenever you might be joining us. We hope and believe that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you belong here. Do we need to take a breath? Let's just take a breath. Calm our hearts. Friends, then will you stand in body or in heart for our call to worship? God forgives us our sins, however great, even when we don't feel we deserve. God forgives everyone their sins,
even when we feel they don't deserve it.
God forgives. Forgiveness is beyond understanding.
Open our hearts to forgive ourselves and others.
Let us pray. Oh, wrong way. God of steadfast love, we acknowledge our shortcomings and seek your forgiveness. We too ask for your mercy and guidance. Help us to turn away from our sins and to live as you inspire and teach us to live. May we extend your love and grace in all we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you're following along in your bulletin, we are swapping the first song and the last song, but we have it ready right here for you.
Patiently, the cross of grief or pain.
Beloveds, we are imperfect people living in an imperfect world, doing our best to love each other and ourselves well, and sometimes we fail. And so we come together to practice and to name and to come before God and each other in a moment of honesty to confess. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that from the beginning of time, we have failed to understand your call to us. We have acted as though we are gods in our own lives. We have acted or failed to act in ways that have led to injustice or oppression. We have turned away from you and sought after other gods, possessions, people, media, and other distractions. Forgive us for all the ways in which we have failed you and our neighbors. Call us back into abundant life of loving service that you offer us in your holy name. Beloveds of God, here's these words of hope. God, who created you in God's image, has redeemed you in Christ Jesus, and for his sake forgives you all the ways you have sinned and fallen short. Receive this forgiveness with joy in Jesus' name. Amen. And as people reconcile to God and to one another, let us share signs of peace with one another. Peace be with you. And then you may be seated, and then our kids can come up if they would like. They don't like. That's okay. I mean, you could just go to Sunday school too. I totally get that. You're like, no, I'm going to, no, we're going to sit down for a minute. They're here now. See, you're not up here by yourself. Hi. How are you? How you doing today? You doing all right? Yeah. Are you the good kid at school? Yeah. Are there bad kids at school? You are. Yeah, I believe that. Are there bad kids at school? No, no bad kids? You guys have some bad kids at school? What makes somebody a bad kid? Not listening. Ignoring people. Yeah. Getting in trouble for purposely ignoring people, not listening. Are there mean people at school? Unkind? Sometimes. Yeah. Do you think that makes them really bad kids? Do you think they could ever be? No, not all the time, right? Do you think they deserve to get into trouble? Not real bad trouble, right? We're like, maybe you should sit down and be quiet for a while instead of, like, I don't know, prison. I don't think, yeah. Well, our story today is about Jonah. And God called Jonah to go to a place called Nineveh. And Nineveh was like, no, those people are literally the worst. And God's like, I know, tell them I'm on my way to punish them. Like Jonah is that cliche of like, wait till your dad gets home kind of thing. Like, wait till someone else gets home and really punish you. But we don't do that, right? No. And Jonah's like, good, you should punish those people. But he doesn't want to have to go talk to them at all. So he runs the other way. Do you know the story of Jonah? Have you heard of Jonah? He's supposed to go this way, and he's like, peace out, I'm going that way. And God sends a storm, because he's on a boat. And so he has to get thrown out of the boat. Okay, you should take care of that. And then God's like, I didn't want you to go over there, but I also don't want you to die. So he sends a fish, and he gets swallowed by a big fish. How funny is that? Would you want to be swallowed by a big fish? Yes? No? No. All right, we got a mixed bag here. So Jonah decides to go and tell the Ninevites, because God was clearly like, he had a plan. And do you think God, he said, God is coming to destroy your city. And do you think God destroyed their city? No. Why do you think that is? What do you know about God? He's caring. Tell me something else about God. What's that? Sharing. Loving. Compassionate. Full of mercy. Do you think Jonah was happy or sad that they were saved? He really disliked them. He was real mad. He was real upset. Do you think God changed God's mind and punished them anyways? No. That's kind of the end of the story. It's a weird ending to a story, but that's okay. There are 7.5 billion people in the world. Do you think all of them are really good people? You know? Do you think some of them do bad things? Do you think sometimes bad things happen to bad people and bad things happen to good people? Yeah. What do you think we should do if, like, in the southern parts of the United States, remember they got hit by a tornado, hurricane and a flood, and people lost their homes? Do you think we should be like, well, you're nice and good, you not so much? Do you think we should? You too, you're not nice and good either. I'm kidding, you're great. Do you think we should decide who gets help and who doesn't based on what we think is good and right and nice? No, no. There are lots of organizations. Have you heard of the Red Cross? Their symbol is, guess what?
A red cross, yeah.
And they help everyone who needs help. Have you ever gotten help from someone? What does it feel like to get help? Does it feel good? Yeah. That's kind of what God does. God gives help to everyone who needs it because everyone is a child of God. Are you a child of God? No. No, I think yes, you are. Yes, you are. So, what do you think we should do then? Should we ignore people? Should we take our brother's things? I got about half of that. My small child language is not very good. Yeah? Should we help people? Oh, nice. Do you think we should help people? Do you think we should judge them first? No. We should love them like God loves them. At least do our best, right? We try. All right. Do you want to pray with me? Okay, bye. We're going to pray quick. And then you can go. How about that? Yeah. All right. Do you want to repeat after me? Okay. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to love everyone else. Amen. Amen. Okay, go.
Today's scripture is a long reading from the book of Jonah. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of God. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and such a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried to his God. They threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. Jonah, meanwhile, had gone down into the hold of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. The captain came and said to him, "What are you doing, sound asleep? Get up, call on your God. Perhaps the God will spare us a thought so that we do not perish." The sailors said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots so that we may know on whose account this calamity has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell to Jonah. Then they said to him, "Tell us why this calamity has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you?" "I am a Hebrew," he replied. "I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were even more afraid and said to him, "What is this that you have done?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them so. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us?" For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea, and then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring the ship back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more stormy against them. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, O Lord, we pray, do not let us perish on account of this man's life. Do not make us guilty of innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked Jonah up and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he made a proclamation in Nineveh. "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered in sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. The Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? And Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come and cover Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, you are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?
Friends, let us pray. Gracious and holy and loving God, may our words, thoughts, and our reflections be a blessing to you this day and every day and always. And put that down for a minute. And also many animals, I think, is a silly end. Oh, see, I changed mic. I thought it would be okay. Jonah is possibly the best prophet ever. In just five words in Hebrew, Jonah convinces the capital of the current empire to reform and repent of their ways, to do no violence or evil. There may not be a prophet who is ever more successful than Jonah. The prophet Isaiah spent 3 years naked trying to convince people to listen to him, and it still didn't work. Jonah said five words, and I don't think it was the start of a speech. I think it was the whole thing. And then he walked out as the best prophet ever. On the other hand, Jonah might also be the worst prophet ever. If we ignore the fact, we skip chapter 2, and the very last verse of chapter 2 was that the fish threw up Jonah onto the land. So it is the fish violently throwing up Jonah. If we ignore the fact that God called him to be a prophet of the northern kingdom of Israel to Assyria, and Jonah didn't make any excuses, didn't argue like Moses, he just noped. I brought a map because I meant to include a map. Modern Israel. This would be the northern Israel. Over here is Nineveh. Joppa is Spain. Spain. He was like, I'm going that way. And that's the part of the story that we know. We know the part where Jonah runs away and ends up caught in a storm, gets thrown into the ocean and, well, the sea, and gets saved by God by being swallowed by a fish. That's the place where Jonah gives up and makes his trek. It seems like a very long trek to Assyria to Nineveh to do what God had called him to do in the first place. Because I think that's the more interesting part of the story. What happens afterwards? Now, in case you forgot, we are a denomination and a community that takes the Bible very seriously and does see it as truth, but that doesn't mean that we have to believe everything happened exactly as it was written. Just so you know, most biblical scholars don't believe Jonah was real. That he did not get swallowed by a fish. This probably did not happen. Jonah, who left the northern kingdom of Israel for the city of Nineveh, if this had been happened, if this were a true story, There was a prophet. It's named in one of the in Kings that is of Jonah, but probably not one who went to Assyria, probably not one who was consumed and then vomited by a fish. We think the book of Jonah was probably written around the 500s after the people of the southern kingdom of Judah, which is around Jerusalem, were returned from exile from Babylon. But if we really wanted to place the story of Jonah in its historical context, of the land of the time, Jonah was probably written 200 years before that, and 30 years before Assyria, of whom Nineveh is its capital, conquered and destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel. In context, Assyria would have been making incursions into the northern kingdom. They were expanding their empire across the Fertile Crescent. They were killing people and destroying things. So when Jonah decides not to go, it's not just because he doesn't like them. It's not because they just don't get along. They are actually their enemies. They're actually doing terrible things. So whether it's reality or propaganda that the Assyrians were incredibly violent and absolutely set on destruction and conquering Jonah's people, they were the current empire of the world, and conquering is a violent act. Jonah would be putting his life at risk, walking into their city, and it was a really long way away. And why does God want to warn them if he's going to destroy them anyways? So, better go to Spain. Now, the Bible is full of lots of different literary genres. And when I was in seminary, I was taught that Jonah was a satire, that it's meant to be funny. Prophets don't just nope in the other direction. Fish don't come up and swallow people. Prophets don't convince entire cities to repent with just 5 words, and no one covers their livestock and other animals in sackcloth and makes them sit in ashes to repent. The livestock didn't do anything. It's funny. And it's absolutely not funny. Because the sailors seem to absolutely believe that they were throwing this man to his death, and they beg for forgiveness, and imagine the guilt that they had felt. Especially if they didn't know that the fish had shown up later. And biblical scholar Robert Alter writes in his commentary on Jonah that to send the prophet to Nineveh would rather be like sending a Jewish speaker to deliver moral exaltation to the Germans in Berlin in 1936. It's not funny. Jonah is putting his life at risk to go to Nineveh. So it makes sense that he didn't walk to the center of the city. He didn't walk the day and a half of the 3-day journey of the city that is inexplicably the size of Los Angeles. It wasn't. It's absurd. It's funny. He walked a day. He didn't even make it to the middle. He walked a day and decided, that's enough. I made it. Maybe he was surrounded by houses. Maybe he was in the bad part of town. He certainly wasn't by the capital or by the castle. It's not a castle. the palace? He probably wasn't in the marketplace. Maybe Jonah just announced in his normal everyday voice that Nineveh was going to be destroyed in 40 days. And he was like, see ya. And just walked back the other direction, sat down on a hill, and waited for the destruction of the people who were the most hated. Friends, I don't know who's watching online, but I know most of you, and on Tuesday or Wednesday morning, did you sit on a hill outside of the city? On Tuesday, did you sit on this hill outside of the city for the end of something that seemed cruel and violent? And when the 40 days were over and we woke up Wednesday morning, did you cry out to God? Did you have a moment of thinking that others were the enemy? Did you wish them destruction? Tell me. There's no one else here except me and you and them. And if things didn't go the way you hoped this week, did you sit on a hill? Did you sit on a hill and plan? Did you cry? Did you hide in bed? Did you cover yourself up with all of the blankets? Did you think you could die, that you couldn't live through the days ahead? It is easy to fall into despair and rage and hatred and hopelessness. And it is easy to get stuck there, to set up a lawn chair, to settle in, to live in those dark feelings. It is easy to lose hope, especially when we're alone. It's easy to believe the worst when we turn into ourselves and hide under whatever shrub we find. It's easy to nurture despair and bitterness, planning vengeance that leads to violence. It's easy to live there. We can lament, and we can lament, and we should. And we should remember also that lament can be a collective activity we do together. And then remember that God is still calling us to mercy and justice, to compassion and kindness. On top of everything else that happened this week, a friend of ours died. We went to the funeral on Friday, and multiple folks got up, during this service and spoke and told stories of his never-ending backing down from a fight for the well-being of people, of others, of those of the margins, of his care for community, of his kindness, of how he didn't do anything halfway. Everything he did, he was all in, fully committed, absolutely unlike Jonah. He didn't run away, and he didn't stop a third of the way in. Jonah was only a third of the way in, and he only said 5 words, and he stayed in his bitterness on the hill and longed for vengeance and violence against others, and he didn't see the image of God in another, and instead he saw them as his enemy, and as God's enemy. But what we do know from our story of Jonah is that God never abandoned him. God never let Jonah go. And we are called to do the work of God. That in our words and our actions of mercy and justice and compassion and kindness, and we are still called to love, to be all in, to not run away, to look out for those without power, and to say words to those with power that bring justice and kindness, to move, to hold on to hope, and to move in love. And I think it's important, and it matters, that Jonah was by himself on the hill. He tried to do it by himself. I I think it's so important that we end up in community with each other. There is still work to be done. There is justice yet to be done. There is love yet to be given. And we grieve and we lament and we cry and we move in love and we rage and we scream and then we be all in for justice. There is work still to do, to walk into the middle of it, despite the fear, despite what might be difficult days to come, despite the uncertainty, despite all of the things. The time ahead will be filled with the same work that we have always been called to do justice and to love mercy, to walk humbly with God, to love our neighbor as ourselves, to care for those on the margins, those without food or clothing or shelter, for those whom love and compassion has been withheld, to set the captives free, to raise up those who have been under heel. Our calling is the same as it has always been, to hold on to hope that we find present in the loving God and then in the life and the teachings and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We live between the world as it is and the world as we hope it will be. And we work and we strive until it becomes. So, beloveds, it might have been a hard week. Let's take a breath. You are not alone. God has not let you go. You have a community here. God will never let you go. From the ends of the earth or the bottom of the seas, we will not be lost. We will not need to be overwhelmed or stuck, but we need to be moved from anger and cruelty. We need not fall into nihilism. We are not alone. We are still called to love. We are not abandoned. Our work of mercy and justice and care have just begun. Friends, I'm going to invite us into a time of prayer, a litany for after the election. It's all up there, but you only have to know, Lord, have mercy, until we get to the end. Let us pray for those who are grieving all across our nation, that they will not. Let us pray for those celebrating their victory, that they will do so without spite or cruelty. We pray for the rich, that in gaining the world, they will not lose their souls. We pray for the poor, that what little they have will not be taken away. We pray that we will heed to the earth's travails and will act for healing of all creation. We pray for immigrants, refugees, and refugees that they will find a place of welcome, prosperity, and safety. We pray for LGBTQ+ families that they will not lose the protections they need. We pray for our transgender siblings that they will not lose access to health care that they need. We pray for those who have suffered sexual violence. May they know that we believe them and hope for their healing. We pray for women in difficult pregnancies that they will not lose their lives. We pray for those who will be forgotten by society that they will the table. We pray for our democracy, that this great experiment will not fail. We cherish the memory of all who have died in the cause of freedom and pray that they will not have sacrificed their lives in vain. We pray for those who have grown tired in the struggle of justice, that their strength may be renewed. We pray for the veil that has been cast over the face of our nation, that it will be removed. We pray for courage in the sure and sustained hope that no tyrants can prevail against your resurrection power. Amen. Beloveds, we come to our time of prayer together, lifting and holding each other up, supporting one another, celebrating with one another. Our congregational prayers this week are for Judy and Peter, St. Martin, and the Smith family. This week's birthday, it's Olivia Obenberger's birthday, and we're celebrating 34 years of membership for Amy Carpenter. 40 years for Renee and Jay Obenberger, and 20 years for Kristen Voskel. And we are for all of their ministry in and among us. We're holding in prayer this week, Jenny and Todd, as you continue to heal. All of those are hurricane and flooding victims and workers, and all of those who suffer from various and diverse natural disasters, for Kathy and Jeannie, Blue and Michael, for Steve's brother John and nephew Sam, friends Carl and Larry, for Corrine's brother-in-law Dan and Jenny's cousin Jan, for Fran and her sister Frida, for Francine's friend Karen and Charlotte's brother Fred, Julia's friend Crystal, Sandy's sister Gail, and for those who are part of but can't make it on a Sunday morning, for Betsy and Bill and Nancy and Vera. Are there others we're holding in prayer this morning? Yes. Their Bill was in hospice last week, right? And has passed. Prayers for Mary and for all her family and those who are grieving today. Unusually quiet today. We hold in prayer all of those who are living in the midst of and under the threat of violence, whether in their home, institutions or everything in between, for those who are living with and loving and caring for those with mental illness. We always keep the suicide hotlines on our rotating screens at the beginning. And so reach out to your friends, keep track of people, give out that number and call if you need help. Let us pray then for the church, for the world, for all those in need. We pray for hope and redemption in times of despair and darkness. Remind us of your unfailing love and redeeming grace. Help us to always seek your forgiveness and guidance. Help us to pray. We pray for the protection of forests and woodlands. They give so much life and beauty to our planet. May they continue to flourish and support all creatures who depend on them. We pray for those in positions of power. Help them to lead in a way that cares for all people and guide them in their decisions that will benefit their communities for generations to come. We pray for those who are experiencing uncertainty of their physical health or those who are struggling with mental health or addiction, or healing from surgeries, or recovering from accidents. We send your comfort and healing to those, to these, and all those we name in our heart. We pray for those who are lost and questioning. May their questions be honored and welcome, and may they find guidance and purpose in you. Be with them on their journeys. We pray for to follow in the footsteps of the faithful before us. May their humility guide our actions, their generosity inspire our giving, and their compassion impact our interactions. And trust all our prayers spoken here and unspoken to you in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray to us, to you, who, and us to pray to you, who is our mother and our father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Because much has been given us, we offer back what we can give. Our offering plate's in the back. Our singing bowl is next to it. Have you pledged? We are collecting pledges today. If you are able to give, that's great. If you're not sure how consistently you're able to give, we understand. There's a lot of work to do in the next handful of years, and so this community is important to the world, at least to this little portion of the world. So let us continue to be part of that. Our singing bowl is supporting Lake Country Caring, giving free things that are needed for those who are, for infant, for household items, for furniture in the area. It's potluck day. Don't forget to come to potluck day. This evening at 5 o'clock, a ritual, a service of first steps and practices of healing from church and religious trauma. That might be you, it might not be. Share it with a friend. Trustees, Bible study, Mahjong, story time on Saturday, newsletters are due on Friday. Hey, mark your calendar so that the third Friday of every month you're like, hey, we're coming back to church because we had a chilly last month. We're just going to go play bingo. Yay! Just bingo. Invite your friends. Is 6 o'clock a good time? I don't know. That's just the time I had. Great. See you on Friday. Fun for all ages. There's lots of things to sign up and participate in. We're going to have a moment of reflection. Yeah? Or do we want to skip it? Okay, we're going to skip it because we're a little tight on time. But we could build a city of God. Let's postlude that. Do you guys want to do it after postlude on our way out?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So, for all that we have been given and all that we are able to give, we offer prayer. Will you join me in prayer? Gracious God, your gifts are all people without expectation. Accept and use our possessions, our time, and our whole selves for the purpose of ensuring that all people receive what is needed for a joyful and meaningful life. Amen. Amen. Beloveds, will you stand as you are able, and will you follow the call of Christ?
Thank you.
Beloveds, from God we cannot hide. And that is a fact. Jonah tried and Jonah failed. Learning his lesson, may we go from here, relishing in God's presence in our lives, letting God be our guide and a blessing. May this be a week for you when you are fully aware of God with you each and every step of the way. Go in peace. Amen.